Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to cover how to create an effect something like this. So obviously, it's inspired by the double helix of a DNA strand, and we're going to do this in GeoNodes. So we'll cover a few basic topics on how to create spirals and how to then add geometry around those spirals. I'll put the full animation at the end of the tutorial, and I will share the original file with my Patreon supporters. So just to begin with, here's a quick overview of the entire geometry node. It's not too complicated as geometry nodes go, but I'll build it up step by step as we go, and hopefully you can pick up a few things as we go along. You can see there's a node here, which I will discuss later, which is currently on a set value, but actually when I originally used it, I used a little bit of automation in here, and I'll talk about that too. So to begin with, we just need to add an object. It doesn't really matter what it is. We just need something in which to build our geometry nodes. So I'm just going to add a simple plane, and we'll open up a new window up here, and we'll say geometry node editor and click new. Now we don't actually need our geometry here, so I'm just going to actually delete that input node. You can see that there is still an object, and as it happens, it's called plane. We'll change that name to helix. And we can now build our geometry node, and everything has to go out into here, obviously. So to begin with, we need to build our initial spiral. I'm going to add, under curve primitives, curve spiral. And if I just join that up straight into the geometry, you can see there it is. But obviously that's not the sort of spiral I want for this effect. We'll go into orthographic view. I turned the resolution down a bit. I used 27, it's up to you. Rotations I set to about 15. You can see there's a lot more in there now. So that's just how frequently it spins around. And I set my start radius and end radius to the same number. So you can now see that's nice and flat. It's not getting bigger. And I set my height quite large. So I set it to something like 300 meters. It doesn't necessarily have to be that big. We'll set this to 150 for the moment and see how we get on with that. So you can now see we've stretched that spring out. And obviously we can adjust the height later, and that's one of the good things of creating it like this, in order to see how that's going. So we've got an initial spiral. If you wanted two spirals, in other words a double helix, you could create that here very easily by just adding a transform and joining it together. But for this effect we only actually need one spiral, although we will appear to have two. So I'm going to add, under geometry nodes, a join geometry node. This is really more so we can see what's going on. We don't actually have to see this spiral, and we won't see it because it's a curve and therefore not renderable. And I'll drop that in there. No obvious change, but we have this little option now to join other things to it. Now I'm going to add, under curve, a resample curve node, and I'm going to take this curve output into here. And what this will allow me to do is to set the number of points that I have along this curve rather than just relying on what comes out of here. I'm going to set that to evaluated, so it's going to look at the parameters of the curve, and based on what's going into here, make some assessments. So we've got more nodes to do down here, but for the moment we'll move on to the next part. So we're going to add an instance, under instances, an instance on points. We'll put that here for the moment. We'll leave a little bit of space because we've got quite a few more nodes to go in yet. And we'll take our resampled curve and just put that into points. No changes yet. And we'll then take that output and just join it into the geometry. I've got another node to put in here, but we'll put that in a moment. And now I want to build the building block of our double helix. I'm going to add, under mesh primitives, an icosphere. I used 0.5 meters and a subdivision of 3. So I can show you what that looks like by just tying that straight into geometry up here. And you can see there is our little icosphere. So that's what we just created. So if I take that and put that into the instance input on that instance on points, you can see we've created a load of little icospheres all the way along our curve. So that's a start. And if we play with the radius, you can see we can get a little bit of spacing between them if that's what we want. I wanted it so they were just touching. So in this case, radius of 0.3 is probably about right. But I also need a little bar, and I need a second sphere. I'm going to add another mesh primitive, which is a cylinder. I left it on N-gon. I set the vertices to just 16. We're going to put quite a few of these in the seam. Side and fill segments, just 1. And we'll start with 0.125. for the radius, and I had a depth of about 4. I'm going to add under geometry another join geometry node and drop that there, and then take that into here. And you can see that's created those little bars. Don't worry about the rotation at the moment. So I'm now going to add under geometry a transform node, and I'm going to drop that in there. This allows me to change the position, the rotation, and the scale, in this case, of the icosphere. You can see if I adjust that, it changes the shape. So I'm going to change the Z position. We'll try 2.3, as that's what I used before. And that sort of put it on the end there. And then I'm going to take a copy of that transform node, take the output of that icosphere into that, and then take the output of that into my join geometry node. It's created two instances of that icosphere, but they're right on top of each other, so we can't see it right now. So for this one, I'll put -1.9, and we'll see how that does. So you can now see we've got a little ball on each end of this rod. So that's quite interesting in itself, but of course, that isn't the effect that I was going for. So we'll now get another transform node. Just set that all to 0, and we'll drop that in here. And you can see we can play with the rotation there. So that sort of rotated it onto the horizontal. We may not need this rotation, so I'm just going to take that off for a minute. This is just an optional. I didn't end up using it because there's another kind of rotation. I mean, if I rotate that again, you can see, although we have them sort of closer to what we would expect, they're not following in the way that you would expect them to follow. So we need to do something a little cleverer. So I'll just take that rotation off. I'm now going to add under curve a spline parameter node. Spline is another name for a curve, really, and this gets some information about where we are on the curve. I'm going to add under vector a combine XYZ node, and I'm just taking the factor, so this tells me where I am on the curve, into X. Now this doesn't give exactly the result that I need or the output that I need, so I also need under utilities align Euler to vector. So this just changes the way that angles are represented. It's just one of those things you need to learn to do occasionally. Could be more user-friendly in that respect, I think. And we'll take that output into the rotation input. And then I will also add under curve, a curve tangent node, and put that into the vector input. Now you should be able to see that it's sort of aware of the rotation now. And I change this to Z and then X on the pivot point. So we're getting closer to where we need to be. And then I adjusted the Y here. So I ended up with 1.57. Let's just try that. Yeah, that seems about right. And you can now see we've got something that looks pretty reasonable. So just to recap, we've got our spline parameter node going into a combine XYZ. I put an offset on the Y here, bearing in mind this is ultimately going to become rotation. A curve tangent node feeding into the vector of this align Euler to vector, and that combined XYZ there going into rotation, aligned the Z axis with the rotation and pivoted on the X axis, and then that feeds into the rotation. That's given us our initial helix, and we didn't really need this node. So actually, just to simplify things, I'm going to remove that node. But it's there if you wanted to add some tweaks to the angles or scales and so on. For my Patreon supporters, you will find when you look at the file, I've actually doubled this section because I've essentially put a miniature version of each of these inside them and made that glow rather than just have a plain shape. But for this tutorial, I'll keep it simple. So what I also wanted it to do was to sort of build over time. So right now, obviously it's just there all the time, but I wanted it to build up from the bottom and complete itself as the frames advanced. So now we'll come back up here. We've got this selection input on the instance on points node. So we're going to use that. So I'm going to add an input, which is just a value at the moment. I'm going to add an index node. I searched for it there. I couldn't remember what box it was in. I'm also going to add a math node. So I'm going to select under the math node less than, and I'm going to put the index into here. And I'll explain what's going on in a moment. and then I'll take the value that I put here and put that into there, and then the output of that goes into the selection over here. So you can see as I increase that value, it's building up our helix. We've already got control of that. Now we could just animate that. We could just put a keyframe on that and then go to wherever we want it to finish in the animation and we're done. But I thought I'd do something a little smarter. So just click in there and type hash frame. So I'll zoom in so we can see. So just click in there and type hash frame return. And you notice it goes purple and it says one at the moment. And watch what happens if I move through the frames. And you can see that number is following the frame number that we are on. So as the frames advance, our helix grows. Now you might not want it to grow quite as fast as that, because remember this is one every frame we get a new part of the helix. So you can see it's going quite fast there. If you didn't want it to grow quite as fast as that, what we can do is add another math node. I'll just copy that one, change this to divide, and just divide it by a number. I put 8, so that means this will only go up an integer every 8 frames. So at 1, that's less than 1, so that's not going to do anything. So you can see it's now growing much more slowly, because it's only integers that matter when you're using indices. I've only got 250 frames, so it didn't get very far. I'll set the end frames to 1000. And you can see we can shoot along there and it's still going. So I'll just zoom in on the whole geometry node setup for the basic system. I'll squeeze it in a little bit so you can have a good look at that. And then really just the last little thing, you'll probably want to put some materials on there. So I'll just show briefly how to do that. We'll create a couple of materials. We'll call the first one rod and we'll call the second one sphere. We'll set one to blue. Perhaps we'll make them glow actually. We'll have an emission material at blue and we'll use the default strength. And then we'll go for the sphere. Set this one to red or orange, whatever, it doesn't really matter too much. Set that one to a sort of red and use the default emissions. So how do we apply those materials to these geometry node generated objects? So we're going to come up here, just go to search and say set material, and there's a set material node. If I wanted to set the material for all of it, I'd put this node in here at this point, but obviously I want them different. So what I'll do is join those there, and we'll put the set material node there for the spheres. I'm going to set the background to black and we'll go to the rendered view and we'll select the sphere material there. So you can see the spheres are glowing and they're actually illuminating the rods slightly. And then I'll take a copy of that set material and I'll put it there. Obviously the rods are now on the same material, but I can just click here and select the rod material. And there we go. So now you can see our little helix is growing with the animation. And if I come out of orthographic view, we can get some interesting views. So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. I will upload the original file for my Patreon supporters to use. If you've got any questions, don't hesitate to ask in the comments below. I do read all the comments and try to respond to all of them. Don't forget to click like and subscribe, because I produce fairly regular videos and I try to select topics that are less common. And I will see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.